Hi, good morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's Church. So glad you're with us. If you're in the lobby, you can go ahead and come on inside. And if you are online, we are thrilled that you're joining us too. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors. And if you're new here, what you found is a community of people that is bent on loving the community God's placed us in, on shaping the culture in which we find ourselves by equipping every generation to follow Jesus. And we're excited to continue that this morning through our worship and being together. So if you're able, I'm going to ask if you'd stand to your feet. We're going to use our voices, we're going to use our minds, we're going to use our smiles, and we are going to give praise and worship to a living King, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning, friends. My name is Josh. I'm one of the youth leaders here, and I would love if we can read God's word together. Can we do that? Beautiful. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and all that is in my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, forget none of his benefits. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed his transgressions from beautiful. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. Praise the Lord, my soul. Beautiful.
Thank you. And I'm thinking, oh God, about the songs we all just sang, the words we sang with our mouth to you, oh God. And I am thinking about the fact that we just sang how wonderful and how marvelous is the Savior's love for me. And I can't help but wonder if there's some people in this room this morning that just have forgotten that truth. And so, Lord, I pray for that person who's here this morning. Maybe it's more than one. Chances are likely it is. That just needs to be reminded that how wonderful and how marvelous is your love for them. And we just praised you, Jesus, because you actually care about the one. We know you love the 99, but if there's one that's gone off, you go after that one. So Jesus, thank you that you are intimately acquainted with every single person that's here this morning. For people that have come for the very first time that are in this room, may they experience how wonderful and how marvelous is your love. May they feel that from you this morning. And for people who have been here for a long time, I just thank you so much for their consistency and their faithfulness, their stewardship, their giving, their thoughtfulness, their service. Lord, thank you. All of this makes up the church, and it's your church. So we just thank you, God, for each person that's here. Holy Spirit, would you fill this room? Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, we invite you to be obvious to each and every one of us now. We need you. We admit we need you. We desire you. We need more of you. So come, Holy Spirit, come. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm not afraid. shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. When my blood is thirsty, set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
I feel like we can all just go home now after that solo and just say yes and amen. Anybody? Wow, thank you. That was so beautiful. I was so touched. Earlier this year, some of you may know, actually this month, in the month of September, we had this incredible event called OC Worship Night, OC Youth Worship Night, where six or seven churches from all over our community came under one name, the name of Jesus, to worship and to have a ball. And actually, it was as a result of some of your generosity in this room that made that night happen. So thank you. You know who you are. Thanks for doing that. It was incredible. And I will tell you that there were 365 students here and 45 adults, yeah, right, who came together to be intergenerational and make it happen. And so here's a highlight video. Check it out. You could sense the energy in that room, and it was incredible. So these are some incredible people who were there that night. This is Reagan. She's in the sixth grade. Can we say good morning to Reagan, please? So glad she's here. Yes. And some of you know, many of you probably know, Suzanne and her husband, Ben, and so great to have you here. Thanks for being part of this. So I just said, can I just ask you a couple questions? And the first one is this. Sorry to those of you who can't see us over there, but Reagan, you were there, and can you just tell us a little bit about your experience there?
It was one of the best nights of my life.
What? Wow. And why was it one of the best nights of your life?
Because I got to hang out with my friends, worship, and realize that church can be fun.
Oh, that is awesome. Can you high five me? Because that's just a fantastic response. Thank you so much. Love that. And you were jumping up and down. You saw yourself in that video. It was so much fun. Suzanne and Ben, here you are. And I saw you there that night. And what I want to know, and what I'd love for you to share with them, is how did you go about even getting involved and volunteering in OC Youth Worship?
Well, Megan, I see lots of friends out there, so I'm going to try to be very transparent. I had no intention of volunteering for that night. Actually, I thought it was a great idea, and I really supported it, but all I could think of were all my limitations. After all, I'm 75 years old. I don't have children of my own, and I can't remember the last time I sat down with a high schooler and had a conversation. So I was just filled with doubts, but as often happens, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me and just wouldn't let go. So I made the decision that I was going to volunteer, and I said, Ben, I'm going to volunteer. You want to join me?
That's so good. And I said, I'll think about it. And after a couple of days reflecting on Pastor Jason's messages about intergenerational worship and leaving a legacy of faith, I sensed the Spirit speaking to me too, that this is something I can do. What's the worst that could happen? And something that I've learned over the years when trying to discern the voice of God is that the voice of God often sounds a lot like your wife.
Can I get an amen?
So we signed up. And as luck would have it, Chase assigned us to the Corner Cafe. That was perfect for two introverts. We could be in there and we could, you know, do what was needed in the Corner Cafe. But when we arrived, there was no one there.
So we were walking around trying to find something to do and feel like we had a contribution. So I was cleaning tables, and still there was nobody there in the Corner Cafe to engage with. Everybody else was out on the patio having a blast. And we saw these two young women out there playing spike ball. We'd never even seen spike ball. So we said, let's go. And we went out and said, hey, how do you play this game? And they showed us how to play, and we started playing badly, very badly.
Very badly.
Yeah, there we are. But we had a good time, and they had a good time.
Surprisingly enough, they seemed to enjoy teaching us and engaging with us. And then, you know, all of those limitations that I had in the beginning seemed to disappear. So we felt welcomed and appreciated. And it ended up that night was just such a blessing to see all of those kids coming from churches throughout the community, just streaming in the doors, and then worshiping our Lord with all their heart. And I wouldn't have traded that evening for anything.
And after the fact, as we reflected on it, another lesson that came back, was reaffirmed, is that we never know what God's going to do if we just show up. So that's what we did.
So good. You guys, thank you. Can we just give it up for them? You guys, thank you so much. Thank you so much. As they were talking, it made me realize that one of our core values here at St. Andrews is intergenerational worship and relationship, right? And you just saw that on the stage. You saw it in the video. And that's what this church is all about. And we want to get better. And I'm going to ask that you would get better with us and just be willing to step out and serve and share and be good stewards of what God has given you, because he's given us all so, so much. So I'm excited also that Jason is continuing his series on human, what are we really? So pay attention to the screens as he gets up on here. Thank you, God.
Welcome home, St. Andrews, whether you're tuning in online or are here live in person, we are so glad that you are with us. My name is Manny, and I have the privilege of being one of the pastors on staff at this amazing church. I want to take a moment to share a few things going on in the life of our community. So here we go. First, the fall season is here, and we have so much planned for our kids and families. That's right. It's time to get your costumes ready and to decorate your car trunks. Why? Because Fall Fest is here. And by the way, when you go shopping, pick up a few bags of candy because we need it. And I promise you that our pastors will not steal any of the candy. Plus, we don't need the calories, your kids do. And so will all the people from all over the city that will be on our campus to celebrate one of the biggest events of the year, Fall Fest. Next, our very own Saatchi, St. Andrews Creative Institute, is in full swing this season. You and your family are invited to a free concert for all ages happening on October 13th to see what Saatchi is all about. Saatchi is also offering new dance classes, Introduction to Dance and Jazz and Hip Hop, on Wednesday evenings from preschool to fifth grade. This is a great way to burn off all those candy calories from the Fall Fest as well. Lastly, calling all couples. Whether you're married or engaged, I want you to consider taking a weekend off and investing in your marriage relationship. Seriously, our lives are filled with so much that demands our attention, and often our marriages get neglected. This is why I am inviting you to a weekend to remember. It's a couples retreat focused on investing in and refreshing your marriage or your future marriage as you're inspired and equipped to move towards oneness in your marriage. This is happening in the month of November down south in the city of La Jolla. But don't wait till November because it will fill up quickly. For more information, head to the Weekend to Remember table in our Connect Center after the service and sign up. Or you can also visit us at sapress.org/events. If you have any questions at all about any of these events or just want to get connected with us here at St. Andrews, please grab a Connect card right in front of you and fill it out and put it in the offering basket. If you're watching online, no worries. Just head to sapress.org/nextsteps and one of our amazing team members will reach out to you shortly. Now, let's continue our worship by giving back God a portion of what He's given to us, His tithes and our offerings. Thank you, church, and God bless you.
Jesus, sing of your marvelous love.
God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image.
There's anything that summarizes what it means for us to want to be human, any cry of the human heart that is just stamped on all of us, I think it's this. It's the desire to be free. Think about all the times in popular culture and movies and in books you've seen this call out to have freedom. What comes to your mind when I say that first? Is it blue-painted William Wallace in Braveheart? Or Mel Gibson in The Patriot? Basically, any Mel Gibson movie is going to have something about freedom. We all know that whenever we sing the national anthem together, where do you find that spot where everybody loses their mind? It's whenever we get to the part that says, "Or the land of the free," and everybody goes crazy. We love the idea of freedom, and we love experiencing it. Do you remember the first time that you got to drive a car by yourself? Remember, like, nobody in there with you, your hair's blowing, and some of you remember when you had hair, some of you? Remember that? What it felt like? It's absolute exhilaration. And here's the paradox, though, is freedom is only possible inside boundaries. Like, if you were driving that car for the first time and you were suddenly free to step on the accelerator with as much weight as you wanted, to go through those back roads or those city streets, but there were no lanes, stop signs, or red lights, you suddenly would feel very different about your freedom. The lack of boundaries causes us to experience not freedom, but fear. And so when we look at the scripture, especially today, as we're talking about this idea of what does it mean to really be human, we have to consider what is this paradox that God has given us in freedom and in boundaries. In fact, it right up at the very beginning of Genesis 2, we find that God builds this into our very nature. We've already looked at Genesis 1 and how he's created everything. He's made man and woman, and he's placed us in the garden. He gave us work to do. He gave us the potential to cultivate goodness and flourishing, and he left us free. And then he says, but there are a few boundaries to help make sure you stay free. Genesis 2, 15 through 17, short passage today, but tons of meaning. It says this: "The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God had set up some boundaries for them in order to protect. In fact, boundaries, when it comes to our freedom and flourishing, they're there to sustain and to maximize our freedom. But how many of you, when you've read that story, you've heard about it as a little kid, you remember the flannel graph Sunday school lesson, how many of you, your thought was, "I bet that one tree was the best looking of all of them." Like as if every other tree in the garden was sort of a Charlie Brown Christmas tree, you know, but this one was beautiful and lavish and lush, and that's not at all what it was. God had given everything that they could possibly want and need, provision and blessing. And then one place, and many of you felt like this, I know I've thought this before, that it was a test. God simply did that just to test them. And he knew that they were going to fail. And you know what? He still does it to me. He puts all this good stuff in front of me, good-looking men or good-looking women or the opportunity to grasp and hold all of this temptation. And what does he expect from me? And some of us feel that that's the way God was treating them in the beginning, but the story of the Bible goes like this. It's always God blessing, God giving freedom, and then him giving law and rule. From the very beginning, it says that he were free, and then he put a boundary to help them sustain it. They break the boundary, they go through it, they decide they want to be their own gods, and the rest of the Bible is the story of him coming to bring them out of the bondage they brought on themselves into freedom again. That's the whole thing. From Abraham through Israel to Egypt to Moses to Jesus, grace goes first, blessing goes first, and then boundary. And it's not because God wants to diminish you, it's because he wants you to flourish. In fact, the biggest lie that any of us has ever bought, and it's the same one that Adam and Eve bought in the garden, is that when you really get freedom, the way to actually find it is you get to define it yourself. That's not freedom, that's autonomy. Some of us, you may remember the first smartphone that you ever got. You remember the first time you got one of those? It was a BlackBerry, you know, the little pad that you could type on in there. Drove your fingers crazy. Had the little roller ball. Some of you, maybe it was an iPhone or something else. The LG chocolate. Anyone? When you got that smartphone, you believed what we were told, right? Two things. This is going to save me so much time. And I'm going to get so much work done. And what's happened? Now you have work everywhere you go. You can't get away from work anymore. And where did all that time go that you were going to be saved from it? When we define stuff ourselves, when we try to grasp for autonomy instead of freedom, we often get ourselves in trouble. And so God said this to the people as he's helping them build their nation. After the story of Adam and Eve, and he's now brought them into a new place of freedom, the nation of Israel, he's building what should be the example for all of us of what a free nation, a free community looks like, one that's living in righteousness and with him. And he says this to him in Deuteronomy as he gives him the law. He says, "This day I call heavens and earth as witnesses against you that I've set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose." See, freedom always comes with a choice. And our choices always have conditions and consequences. He said, "I have given you, I've made you free to choose, and I put before you blessing and curse. But you got to pick. Choose life." God wanted their good. He wants us to choose what's right and good and flourishing and abundant, not death. And he says, "Why choose it? So that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him." Our freedom always leads to choices, and I want to talk to you about that for just a moment. As we're making choices, we have to recognize and honor the boundaries that God has given to us, and they're for our good. Four things that God's boundaries do, what they're meant to do. First, God's boundaries are always meant to protect. They're always meant to keep us safe from emotional, spiritual, physical danger. Stuff that just like a little kid with their parent, we can't quite see down the road how it's going to play out. But God in his wisdom and sovereignty knows, and he puts boundaries around us first to help protect us. If you ever think about a garden, a really beautiful garden, whenever you put a fence around a garden, does the fence do anything to restrict the flourishing of the plants inside? No. Those can grow and have fruitfulness and be beautiful. The fence is meant to keep the inside plants from outside predators, from things that would come in and destroy and damage. The first thing God does with the boundaries he gives us is to protect us. But this fence, though, it has another purpose that it serves. And I was reminded of it this past week. I went to go visit my mom down in Louisiana for her birthday. Got a chance to stay with them for a bit. And where they live, since the last 20 years, they've lived across the street from this huge park. And the park has softball fields and a swimming pool, and it's got a playground. It's got open space. It's a beautiful park. It takes up several city blocks. And I noticed this time that I was home that there were a whole lot more kids in the playground than I had remembered being there. And I got a little picture of this. What I asked my mom, like, "Hey, why do you think there's more kids?" And she's like, "Oh, it's because they put up a fence." I was like, now that seems odd, right? Why would a fence around a playground cause kids, more kids to come, more families to enjoy? And it's this, it's a total psychological and social experiment. In fact, one study was done on a playground where they put kids with a teacher or caregiver, and this playground had no boundaries, no fence, it was wide open. Where do you think the kids stayed in that playground? Right in the center. The lack of boundary, the lack of clear marker kept them afraid of venturing out to the edges. In fact, the experimenters, the sociologists found that not only did they stay in the center, they remained close to the caregiver, and the games they played were less creative. They did way more things that required structure and rules and direction from the caregiver. They placed the same group of kids in a playground that was bounded. It was still large, but it was bounded by a fence. And the kids explored every area of the playground. Their games became much more make-believe, made up. They were experiencing and using creativity and imagination. I want you to consider with me this morning that one of the things that God's boundaries are meant for us is not just to protect us, but to maximize our joy like that fence around a playground. Maybe what God is trying to do is not to inhibit you from experiencing pleasure, not to be a killjoy, but to actually create space and stability and security for you to become everything that He meant you to be. Does that challenge your conception of God's boundaries and rules? To maximize our joy. It's interesting, we live in a what's considered a dopamine culture. In fact, there's a recent book called Dopamine Nation. And what the whole premise of the book is that we live in a time where there's so many options and activities that give us quick little dopamine hits. You know what dopamine is, right? It's the feel-good chemical. And basically what happens is anytime you are either anticipating an activity that's pleasurable or experiencing one, you get a little chemical dopamine hit. And it basically says, yeah, that was good. God's design for us is that we would not have cheap pleasure, but that we would experience deep pleasure. And yet, we find ourselves, because of what some have called the hypodermic needle of the 2000s, our smartphone, that it delivers to us these cheap little dopamine hits, likes, mindless entertainment, porn. Stuff that simply goes into us, gives us a fast hit, and then it's gone. And what God intended in His boundaries with how we should use our time, our space, our energy, He intended for us to experience deep and lasting pleasure. See, so some people are trading a like on their social media account for the cultivation of a real friendship. Sometimes we trade the quick fix of pornography instead of the deep development of intimacy in a real relationship. Sometimes instead of mastering a skill or becoming a person who builds and creates, we settle for just mind-numbing entertainment and scrolling. God's boundaries were meant to give us maximum joy. Psalm 16:11 says this, "You make known to me the path of life. You fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand." This is what He wants for us. Eternal pleasures, not momentary, cheap dopamine hits. Thirdly, they don't just protect us. The boundaries of God don't just maximize our joy, but they foster dependence on Him. Part of what it means to be human, and we've talked about this, is that we have limitation. Ben and Suzanne talked about the limitations they felt with volunteering with these kids. We experience places where we're not everything that we can be or that we believe we should be. We're limited, and that's a good thing. Embracing our creatureliness is a good thing. How many of you have heard of this movement? It started probably 100 years ago, but it's picked up a lot of pace recently. It's called transhumanism. Heard of transhumanism? It's the idea that we can take technology and we can harness medicine, technology, and other forms of breakthroughs to enhance humans so much so that we actually become what's called post-human. That we exceed all of the God-given limitations for us, that we might be able to live forever, that we might be able to eradicate all of our weakness, that we could connect, and this has actually happened, we can connect our brain, our organic matter brain, with processing units that allow us to communicate through the internet with AI. That we're becoming what could be called post-human. This attempt that we have, it's like we want this freedom. We want to be free of the shackles of limitations of humanity. We want to be God. And yet he says, it's not good for you, so I've placed a boundary there. One pastor said it like this, that we don't have all the answers. We need God's wisdom, and we need to trust him to give it. And that as we try to self-exalt the human, the more we go down this path of trying to exceed the God-given boundaries we have, that we don't find we become more human, we find that we're dehumanized. We become less of what we were intended to be. One pastor said it like this, the irony is that human autonomy feels like we've gained significance when in fact we've lost our sanity. Freedom from God feels exhilarating, but it's the exhilaration of skydiving without a parachute. Cheap dopamine hits, exhilaration that ends in destruction. This is what's before us when we get outside God's boundaries. They're for our protection. They maximize our joy. They foster our dependence, and they reveal God's goodness. When you truly, and I know right now some of you are like, I've heard this kind of message before. He's going to tell me all the things I'm not supposed to do. And you're right, that's going to happen in just a minute. And don't worry, I'm going to offend every single person here. If you don't feel a little bit offended by the time I'm done, I didn't do my job well. So just get ready. But God says, I am giving you these boundaries in order to show you how good I am. Just a couple of verses you can write down and meditate on later. Joshua 1:8, the book of the law shouldn't depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do all that's written in it. For when you do, I will be your slave master. No. When you do, you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. Psalm 119:45 says, I'll walk about in freedom, for I've sought out your precepts. The freedom I'm looking for, I'll get to walk out when I follow the path of your law. And in James 1:25, he says, whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they've heard but doing it, they'll be blessed in what they do. There's this opportunity that we have to experience God's goodness by living according to his boundaries. So let me give you four boundaries that are clear in Scripture. In fact, all four of these we've already seen in the Genesis passages 1 and 2 that we've looked at. And each of these, if you draw out the implications of this principle that I'm going to give you, you'll see that they impact all of your life. But it's real important that at least we understand the choice that we're going to make on whether to follow and to stay inside God's boundaries or to break down the fence and go out. You got to understand what you're choosing. So here are four. The first boundary in Scripture, God says, worship me alone. Very first one, first commandment of the Big Ten, have no other gods but me. I alone am your God. Why did he do that? It's because he knows that anything that we worship, we become like. Whatever it is that you worship, you begin to look and act and you become like. And God says, I've designed you in my image and likeness. You remember, you are to become more and more like me. Now, it's easy for us to go, well, that's simple. I got this one, Jason. Don't worship any other gods. We don't deal with a lot of idols these days. There's not like stuff sitting on the mantle in your house that you're bowing down to. We don't live in a Hindu culture primarily, so there's not 130 million gods and goddesses to choose from. It's fairly simple. You're like, yeah, I'm good. Except, here's what worship looks like. It's anything that you give your affection to that becomes priority in your life, that, as Tim Keller says, if you lost it, you think you'd die. So what is it in your life, maybe, that you've placed above God? What is it that maybe you've allowed to capture your imagination and your affection? Great. Were we all guilty as charged? Or is it just me? All of us, right? That one got us. Okay, great. Number two. Another thing that he says, boundary in Scripture. All life is valuable and it's mine, he says. All life, in every form, in every stage, with all of its ability, with all of its disability, any human life that God creates, it is his and it's valuable. And we are to respect that boundary, to value it as well, with dignity and worth and protection. It's so interesting to me, God so much loves the human, and he so much cares for the dignity of us as humans, that there's this place in Genesis just a little bit later, it's in Genesis 9, where God is talking, it's after the flood, and he says, I will even hold every animal accountable for the human blood that it sheds one day. So like lions that tear apart the hunter on safari, those sharks that have eaten the person in the ocean, God says, I will hold the animals accountable. Does that not blow your mind a little bit? That this is how much God prioritizes human life, and so should we. Third one, sexual purity. It's clear in Genesis 2, he says, the man and the woman come together in marriage. That's where sexuality is to be expressed, and it's for our good. It's not to minimize your pleasure, it's to maximize it. And here's the thing, can I just ask you a question? You already know this, and every one of us has been affected by people who've crossed this boundary, or we have ourselves. Every one of us. So we're all in the same boat, okay? How many of you know that if you cross that boundary line, has it made the relationship that you were in clearer, less complicated? Did crossing God's sexual boundary line make your relationship less drama or more? Every time, we know this. And it's because he's designed it so that we might experience the fullness of his intention for us, the goodness of it, with security and stability. Because what happens is people cross that line and then suddenly one is having fun and the other is having commitment. Or one is just experiencing this deep emotional connection and the other says, this is just biology. And this is why God created. See, we don't get to define these things when we try to say, I want to be autonomous and free and define it myself. What we find is pain. Fourthly, God is the owner of everything and we're his stewards. He says that here's a principle. All of your stuff, all of your money, all of your gifts, all of your time, all of you is mine. And you're a steward. And you get to manage it like I would manage it. Manage it well. Manage it for the flourishing of others. Manage it righteously. But you don't own it. And what happens when we cross that and we begin to feel like it's ours is we start to think we've got to do anything we can to protect it, to grasp and to hold, and greed takes over and we become the very thing that we didn't want, bound instead of free. See, that's the issue, is that we have a different definition of freedom than God does. The human definition for freedom is, I am free from. Free from your expectation, free from your rules, free from any of those things. I am free from that. But God's definition of freedom is, you are free for. I've set you free for flourishing. I want you to experience all that I intended for you. In fact, in the New Testament, Galatians, Paul says it like this. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and don't go back to a yoke of slavery, for you were called to freedom only, here's the free for part, do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. In other words, don't just spend your freedom on yourself, but through love, serve one another. That's what we're free for. We're free to serve others, to love others the way God would love them through us. This is why you're free. It's the paradox of Christianity. We're the most free people of all people in the world. We have the most freedom. We're set free from the penalty of our sin, from the guilt of our sin. Jesus did that in his life, death, and resurrection. We're set free from having to live according to the elemental principles of this world, as Paul would say. We're free from the power of that. His Spirit working in us makes us possible to say no to the things that would destroy us. We're free, and yet We're the most bound people in the world too, because we're bound as slaves to Christ and to one another. So, here's the thing. Everybody has to choose. You either choose boundaries or you choose bondage. You choose boundaries or you choose bondage. Here's what I mean. When I was home with my mom, they have a new dog. And this dog, I got a picture for you. This dog is huge. You can't tell from that picture, but it's like 110 pounds or something. And he doesn't quite know. He didn't know exactly like how big he is. You know what I mean? Like a middle school kid. They don't quite understand their body. And so whenever they would take him out to walk, my mom's like a little lady, and so she's holding on to this 107-pound dog, and it would make other people nervous, right? So the trainer that they got said, well, you're going to have to start having him. By the way, he wasn't this big when they got him, so they called him Biscuit because it was cute, and now he's like the biggest biscuit you've ever seen. But they're like, he's going to have to use one of these. You guys ever muzzle-trained a dog before? You know how you do it? It's so fascinating. What they did is the trainer said, okay, when you first get this, he's going to hate it. This is going to absolutely drive him nuts, and you don't want to get your hands anywhere near that mouth with this thing at first. So what she did is she put a little plastic wrap in it, and the trainer's like, what's Biscuit's favorite thing? And she's like, oh, that's easy. Rocky Road ice cream. I know, right? My dog loves Rocky Road. And she's like, all right, put some Rocky Road in there. So they just left the muzzle on the ground with the little Rocky Road ice cream, and Biscuit would come over and stick his head in there and eat it. And they did that for 3 or 4 days, and he got pretty comfortable with it. And then they said, okay, now take the muzzle and put the ice cream in and hold it close. And so they would do that, and he began to be okay with it. And they said, and then take this strap and just put it over his neck. Don't attach it yet, just hang it there. And Biscuit would walk around with the muzzle and the ice cream in it, you know, happy as he could be. Until one day, they put the muzzle on and they fixed it, and he was stuck. And I think, here's how I want to end today. I think some of us, we're walking around like, how did this get here? What happened? I just crossed the... I mean, God didn't really mean... I mean, clearly, he didn't understand today, like the culture, he didn't. And you ended up going after something that looked right, felt autonomous, and you're in bondage. And I got to tell you, some of us, we look kind of silly walking around like this. And you don't even know it. And so what I want you to consider with me today, and believe me, I'm doing this too, it's like, where have I chosen to ignore one of God's boundaries? And I'm in bondage now, and I didn't mean to get there. I don't want to be here. See, there are places in your and my life that you're not experiencing everything that God intended for you because you thought you made the rules yourself. Because our free choices, they have consequences. And everybody chooses. Here's the thing. You have to choose what you're going to be bound to and what you're going to be free from. Because everybody is free and bound at the same time. So you decide. Do you want to be free from sin? That means you're bound to righteousness. It means you're bound to God's way. You want to be free from all those rules and righteousness? It means you're bound to sin. It means you're bound to the destructive nature of what happened to Adam and Eve in that garden when they chose to go past the boundary and God said, now I have to do something. And even in his answer to their breaking the boundary, tearing down the fence to become God, even in his answer there was grace because he took them out of the garden, Genesis 3 says. He removed them from it so that they would not eat from the tree of eternal life and be forever stuck in this state of bondage. And the rest of the story and Jesus' mission and what he's still doing today is setting people free from that choice so that we can experience all that God intended. There's a TED Talk that's real popular. I'm closing with this. Hi, wake up. And the TED Talk is by Barry Schwartz. It's called The Paradox of Choice. And in it, you've probably been wondering this whole time, why is there a fish tank with fish in here? In the TED Talk, he says, it's interesting, we have this belief that we need to maximize our freedom, our individual freedoms, and by doing that, the way that we do it is to maximize our choices. And he's like, then I go to the grocery store and there's 175 salad dressings. And I'm overwhelmed. And in today's culture, we have to decide everything. We have to. We can't just receive our identity. We have to choose it now. We have to. And so every day you wake up and you're trying to figure out all the decisions that need to be made for you to just exist as you. And it starts over every single day. And he said, you know, if we could get inside the psychology of these little goldfish, I bet what we could hear them saying is like, "Look at that big dude outside keeping us in this glass enclosed cage. What does he know about us? Why doesn't he set us free? You know? Why didn't he let us out, take away the choices, give me freedom?" They're fake. Relax. Don't call PETA on me. Why doesn't he set me free? And you know, and I know, and they know that actually removing all of the removing the fishbowl doesn't lead to more choice and freedom. It leads to death. And he says, I think that humans, this is a secular psychologist, by the way, I think that humans need a fishbowl because the absence of it is a recipe for misery and I suspect disaster. You know who said that first? God in Genesis 2. So today, I'm going to ask you to pray with me. And we're going to pray in this way. The first part of the prayer is, God, show me where I've bought a lie about one of your good boundaries. Show me where I've decided myself to throw off the shackles of that and I'm going to do it my own way, or I bought a lie from the culture. Would you show it to me first, and we're going to confess it, and then we're going to ask him to give us power to live this way, that you and I would trust that the freedom he offers is found within the boundaries, not outside. And then we just align our life to that by the power of Christ. By the way, if you're not a Christian, you're not a Christ follower, and you're like, I don't think I could ever do that. I don't think I could live my life that way. You're right. And we can't either, those of us who claim Jesus. And the only way we can do it is not on our own. It's with his resurrection power coursing through us. So your next step, and I would just say, trust me, your next step is to say yes to Jesus, to receive his gift of indwelling presence and salvation, and to watch what he does as he sets you free. So, Father, we pray this morning that you would illuminate for us those places where we've chosen other than your good plan, other than your boundaries. God, there are fences that we have taken down that it's just been sin. So, God, I ask first you'd forgive us. I ask you to show us that, and then you'd forgive us, and we would be able to trust. The good news of grace is that all of us have broken those. And if we feel convicted right now, if we feel in a place like guilty, God, you have a prescription for that. And it's the cross of Jesus, and it's the forgiveness he offers. And so first, as we confess, would you forgive us? And then, God, I ask that you would show us the truth. Show us the places where we bought a lie, and would you empower us? Would you motivate and encourage us? Would you inspire us to choose to trust you inside these boundaries so that we could actually be free? For Jesus, it's what you came to do, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I invite you all to rise as you're able as we sing this final hymn of our worship service. One of the great blessings we have in singing the hymns and songs of the church is a lot of times we get to sing interpretations of Scripture. We saw the words earlier of Galatians 5. There's a modern hymn writer by the name of Carolyn Gillette who set the words of Galatians 5, "For freedom Christ has set us free." Let's sing this all together as our hymn of dedication.
if you've got questions or needs or something on your mind, we've got folks that would love to pray with you over to my right, and we'd love to engage with you right where you are in your faith walk. And if you are walking out these doors today and somehow part of you feels like, oh, got me, that's good. God's going to be good to you in that. His grace is enough to meet you where you are and to walk you like baby steps toward his fullness. So I pray that this week as you go, you would experience not only the freedom that Christ came to bring you, but also the joy that he promises is found as you live his way in his world. So go in peace, St. Andrews. We love you guys. Have a great week, and we'll see you next Sunday.